Thank you all for joining us on this beautiful Saturday afternoon at the Richmond Art Center, where we are delighted to have Hung Lu and Michael Hall here with us in conversation as we are celebrating our 80th anniversary of the Richmond Art Center. We are really indebted to those who have supported the Art Center and our programs, particularly the J. DeFeo Foundation, Elizabeth Moyer, and Michael Pawanda Charitable Trust, Jacobs & Company, Zellerbach Family Foundation, William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, the Elizabeth Firestone Graham Foundation, and Susan and Stephen Chamberlain. And it is through this generosity that we're able to have this fabulous exhibition, a video recording of these programs for those who couldn't join us at the time and for those who will benefit in the future from these incredible insights and sharings, really deep sharings of the artists. And none of this would be possible without the devotion of the artists in this exhibition who support the Art Center, support the mission of the Art Center, and are here to really give us a great gift today. So thank you, Hung. Thank you, Michael. Hung, you have brought so much of your personal experience to your work, and at the same time, you have used historical events and images and language. And Michael also has worked with very, very personal experience and family history and used it as a cipher, really, for that which has happened all around us throughout the world. And how was it when you first met each other? I know you've had a very long and rich relationship as teacher and student, as mentor, mentee, artist assistant. You've worked as an artist assistant. You were a teaching assistant before that, and your colleagues teaching. How was it to find each other and to recognize this, you know, these sympathetic qualities in each other in your work?
Oh, hello. There we are. I can project. So I was really fortunate to meet Hung just before coming into Mills College. And she really made me feel welcomed into that community and really impacted me. I'd worked at Creative Growth Arts Center for a while, so I really do believe in centers like the Richmond Art Center, Southern Exposure, Creative Growth, these art centers that really bring community together. The Bay Area is rich with these places. And I think we are all so fortunate for that. And I think Hung is one of the people that I had known that and experienced that, but I'd never really seen it in the intensity that I had seen when I started working with Hung at Mills. She just gave so much to her students. Both undergraduate and graduate, I was fortunate enough to work with Hung in one of her final years at Mills as a graduate student.
When did we meet?
It was...
How many years ago?
End of 2005. Yeah, 2006. It was, I think that's when. We like ran into each other outside of the gym. Outside at the corner of like the YMCA, I remember the YMCA was there and Creative Growth was down the road and we ran into each other on the road. And I told you I was applying for Mills and you were very...
I just hung out there, YMCA, waiting for young people pass by.
And that kind of is the magic that Hung brings. It's like you run into her in odd places and she's still so very generous with the students. So I was very fortunate to be able to experience that, and that experience has informed me so much on like how to maneuver my life going forward as an artist, as a teacher, as a human being. Just the generosity that you give and that you put forward is an important quality.
Yeah. I have to say, coming here, first of all, so surprised to see so many of you here. It's a beautiful Saturday, you're sitting here to listen to us. And just I thought a lot by sitting through last program between Jew and Squeak. Squeak and I, we know each other forever. We call each other sister. Yeah. But, you know, we exchanged the notes of teaching. Jew, believe or not, was an undergrad at Mills. And Michael was a TA. So we had a Jew, and then she went on to Berkeley to graduate school. And I had a job at Mills, was a J.D. Fields position. For 20-some years, I have a drawing, a reproduction drawing of the eyes on my wall, just watching me all the time. I have a chair, you know, her chair. I sat the chair, I didn't pay much attention after maybe 15 years, the chair broke down. Then I refused to let people take away. I said, just live here. I got a new chair, but her chair is there. And now I pass on to Yulia Pinkusevich, who took my position. I said, here's J.D. Fields' chair. So I feel the continuity is so important. As a teacher, I have had so many students, undergrad, grads. And in old China, we used to say teacher just like a father, another father, but this olden days only man could be teacher. But now I feel like they are my young colleagues. And in working with them, it keep me on my toes, especially I'm from China. Once in a while, they say things. I said, what was that? You know, two of my TAs, believe it or not, don't tell anybody else stays here. Two of them, older women, they said, have you ever heard a good vibration? I said, what? They said, we take you there. You so naive. You so, you know, like I need to be educated. So the two of them took me, they took me there. I felt like you never know what you learned from high to low. But what I'm saying is I'm from a family with now four generations being teachers. My grandfather, mother, and me that my son is teaching. And but I sense a lot of students, they all almost like my children. In that way, and Michael just got his tenure track teaching position, and called East Bay, right? East Bay, it used to be Hayward. So I felt like, oh my God, I remember when I got this job offer from Mills, how excited I was. And it's not just a simple position, but it's loaded with a lot of, weight and responsibility and joy, and just endless. And I just felt this great continuity. I have students, former students, they asked me for a letter of recommendation. Listen, I need a job. I'm in return to New Zealand. That's Lucienne. Return to New Zealand, I need a letter from you. I'm applying for a teaching position. The same time I got the school, send me a questionnaire, many of those. And I really liked her. I didn't lie anything, but I did a glorious letter of recommendation. Then I heard she got a job in New Zealand. And sometimes this is the moment you feel that your work, as teacher, I feel when Squeak mentioned about the grammar school, and I remember once I listened to a radio show, said, do you remember last year who won the Academy Award, the leading actor or leading actress? Sometimes you do so fuzzy, you know, you watch, but you do remember the best teachers in your life, even go way back. I remember when I was elementary school in China, I was just, I didn't accept that only boys could play soccer. I said, I'm going to play. And the teacher didn't say, oh, girl, go back. And I joined them first. The boys are so scared. I was like, what are we going to do with this girl? Then they realized I was nasty. Then they started to, be very tough on me. But this time, I remember also, so lucky, when I finally, after 4 years, waited for my passport to be issued by Chinese government, I entered a UCSD graduate program. There are great faculty there, like from Manny Faber to Eleanor and David Anton, and my advisor was Alan Caprow. He was so famous for happenings. I'm a painter. I studied the mural at graduate school in China. What could he teach me? Over the years, I realized that the good teachers, they prepared you for the future, the possibility. They encourage you. They not necessarily only to teach you how to draw, how to sculpt. They do that as well, but most importantly, I feel they encourage me to be myself. That's what I always remember. I always have this, kind of a mantra said, to students, find yourself, find your own voice, find your own, metaphor, your own dream, your own anything. And when I said that, then finally I said, I'm so happy I read Oscar Wilde's quote, said, be yourself. Everybody else already be taken. And then I should like, good, being a teacher, you have to be yourself, willing to share your experience. Most importantly, to encourage your students to be themselves and to overcome any, and art is such a strange thing. In China, I was, no matter how much I love to do art, but I was basically pressured to study something else for a woman, useful, like medicine. So I was preparing to do that, but luckily, but one thing or the other. What I'm saying is I feel so fortunate to be able to share this with you, to be able to teach at Mills for over two decades, and so many graduate students, undergraduate students, sometimes out of blue in the middle of maybe Kansas City, and they said, remember, I was your teacher. I was so embarrassed, I didn't remember. But I felt like that's, in Chinese, we call Tao Li Man Tian Xia, meaning teacher, you are a gardener, and the peach and the pear flowers all over the world. So that's, and Michael is such a unique, one of the best grad students and friends. And what I just want to add one more thing. If you don't mind, his mother and his parents live in Tennessee, and his mother once visited when we had a dinner. She granted me to be Michael's West Coast mother. So I have a new title, it's like so happy.
Me too.
I'd like to touch a little bit on the enormous differences, both just in the cultural environment, in China and in California, and in the educational environment in which you spent time in both. And I was wondering how the first experience impacted your evaluations, appreciation, how it influenced how you participated in California education and society, and how you think that might have inflected your teaching and been an influence in some way.
In China, technique is very important, still is. In the 50s, China directly, you know, copied the Soviet Union, our big brothers, education, the whole system, art also is called a socialist realism. So the style is realism, but you have to serve the party line, meaning serve the socialist country. So even today, you go to a Central Academy of Fine Art, CAFA, in Beijing. I was just there April, late March, April. They have almost like a temple with all the life-size replicas of Michelangelo's sculpture and all the famous sculptures from mainly from Europe, and the setup is really like temple because it's a circular architecture. You look up how many feet could be 50 feet high with a dome there, and the students set up their easels doing long-term drawings. You can do your drawing after Moses, after we call the long-term project. Could be 100 hours. The paper sheet is pretty big. The easel, almost semi-permanent, stand there. And we visit. I think that's how academic we, you know, after all these years, still so important. You have to have the skill, you have to have the patience to portray from a still life to statue, then to life model, and step by step. That's, I think that's nothing wrong with sharpen your knife if your skill is part of your tool. But if that's only, that's one thing. Some of, I remember my professors and some even my contemporaries just basically stuck there. They can paint model one after the other. That is so perfect, but beside that, you know, what else? So I think when I got to UC San Diego and I met Moira Roth, our art historian, very well-known feminist writer, and she handed me some catalogs, and she invited me to her class, talk about the feminist movement, the women's building in LA. I was like really stunned by the work that people could make. And then when I was TA, and the students, I learned a lot by being TA. It's not only focus on skill, but also your concept is very important. And remember when Alan Caprell conduct a class, he was teaching happening. And one day he had a truck. I remember he hauled some old sofa chair. And I think the very small class, like six, seven people, most of them are undergrads. I was the only graduate student. I'm from China, probably. Very important. I feel like I needed to take any classes possible. And then he took us to the dumpster. He got his sofa chair there next to the giant dumpster and the buckets of paints. And he said, okay, do something. I said, do what? Because I was trained in such a conservative way. You have to do drawing, you enlarge it, you do some, like you have to like take the right steps. What is this? I know it's a happening class, but still I was standing there. I'm waiting for instruction. And then there's an undergrad, I remember, young man. He just grabbed a bucket of paint, just pour right onto the chair. I almost fainted. It's like, oh my God, this is you do art? Oh my God. But also a moment of liberation, you know, a revelation and feel, oh my God, you can do this? Then I remember actually in Chinese traditional painting, there's some crazy artist. They have to have a lot of wine, got very drunk, and in the olden days, man had long hair. They got their hair dipped into the ink, and the rice paper on the floor. That's just like a, exactly. It's like a, just performance art. It has been done here as well, but in the 20th century. And then I said, you know what? That's the thing. As a Chinese artist, I need to empty whatever there, accept anything, everything first, and just absorb and try out the different things. Some of my classmate, Christine, what was the name? Christine, the performer artist, she died. Tumbling and did performers crawl on the floor, and another graduate student did he made lunch every day, invite people, certain number, small group of people. The chatting, that's a graduate student artwork. I said, oh my God, this is so. But I feel that the liberation is very important. The way when you let yourself off the hook and get out your comfort zone, you don't know what will happen. And that's, I think, over the years, maybe with the graduate student and students, I just say, do something, do anything, get your canvas dirty. Don't worry, this is not your first painting, won't be your last, but just, go do bad painting, do whatever, or maybe go beyond painting, just go 3D, add something else. This part, Michael is so good because maybe his generation, not only that, because he has been teaching for a long time, creative growth is a very unique place, but also teaching other students. He has been teaching Carl and Mills and different places. So he handles not just painting, not just a photograph. He also, in here you can see, he does a video. It's almost this, a kid when the young age, like from infantry time, that just started to have a nanny probably speaks Spanish, and then somebody speaks Chinese, and he speaks a language switch from one to the other freely. And I envy that, and I think it's too late for me to learn even English, well, second language.
I mean, Hung has also done that. She's made a few videos and did a performance down at the San Jose Museum of Art too. So she isn't as conservative as she claims she is there.
And installations.
Yeah.
Fortune cookies, I'm thinking, and public art, and extraordinary printmaking that's very explorative and demanding in different ways.
Yeah, and I think that's something that Hung definitely imparted on all of her students, is the that ability that to propel yourself into anything that is of interest to you. So like learning skill, having ability, but then what do you do with it? You know, like you said, you know, that's the big question. So I think that's the thing that is the largest challenge to a student. And I mean, that's something that I've continued in my teaching as well, is that, you know, when I teach, you know, a beginning painting class, I stress with them, you know, that this is, you know, you're learning skills, you're learning ability. And while you're learning that, you need to start thinking about why you're doing this, why you're painting, why you're doing this activity, what you're going to do with it, and trying to ingrain that very early on, because I think having skill is very useful. It's a toolbox, you know, and the more tools you have in your toolbox, the more things you can do and call on different things, but it's always comes down to what are you going to do with it. And I think that as artists and as is the biggest question that we have to ask ourselves. And as teachers, that's the thing that really I'm trying to imbue in students, and to embrace failure as well. You know, like that you know, failure is a healthy activity. You know, you don't want to always fail, but you know, you want to learn from your failures and propel yourself from there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a very good point.
It's at the other side of Jay DeFeo's chair, or Catherine Brown had Diebenkorn's chair in Crown Point Press for a long time, and we hold on to things. So, Michael, what are some of those points of those touchstones for you? Are there any particular things that are associated with that time that you carry forward with you?
From Mills?
From Mills.
Oh, and my
from,
gosh. I think the community that we built there was really significant. And I think that I was really lucky. I think the cohort that I was in are all still very dear friends that we continue to challenge each other and push each other's work. And you know, building a relationship with Hung and Jeff, who have been amazing mentors to me over the years, and you know, become family. I mean, you can't put a price on that. And many hilarious nights and very meaningful conversations.
You did the lecture series at the Mills.
Yeah.
You're in charge with inviting artists to speak at the Mills. Yeah. You did a lot of work, I remember.
I have a tendency to kind of overbook my calendar with things. So I took on a lot of extracurricular activities while there.
So Michael, in addition to teaching and to receiving residencies, most recently from the Joan Mitchell Foundation in New Orleans, has also received a community arts leadership award too. As you can see, he's very active. I think for a lot of people, we have a sense of what a teacher-student relationship is generally, what it can be, what an extraordinary relationship sometimes blossoms. But the role of a studio assistant might be a little less defined in the minds of others. And of course, is this different as the artists who have assistants and those who take on all those tasks? So one thing that I'm curious about is in the studio, which is such a private and intimate space when you're making art, and painting is, you know, painting is described so many different ways, from being you know, alchemy, being, you know, transported in another zone, all those kinds of things. But the act of painting itself is a very strong and potent activity. How is it to have someone in your space working and being both very close and keeping distance and being aware and also not being aware? How does that function for you?
I can never paint anybody at my studio. Tell you the truth. Not that I try to hide my secret weapon. I don't have. But I need a concentration. Even my dear husband sometimes just visit me unexpected. I said, can you leave, please? Can you leave? Sometimes I was not polite even. I was just like, please leave. And Michael only came one afternoon, I believe, right? That time, a couple afternoons. And we did a lot of paperwork, like he helped me. He write, you know, English, my second language, so he's faster. Let's do a letter of recommendation, so-and-so, like Jewel, you know, applied to graduate school. And some applied for jobs, and then we do the, my resume, and we plan on things. So we do that kind of thing. It's not a, I'm old-fashioned, I'm not like some Chinese artists really can afford hire young artists to do their paintings. I think some you have to, like a big sculpture cast, you cannot do that by yourself. But the painting is my private space, my domain. Nobody can touch. I don't want anybody to touch it, and I am having fun. Even I'm doing bad painting, I'm still having fun. Why I hire, pay somebody having fun for me, you know? So that's how it goes. I don't want to paint in public, and it's, over the years, there's one case, it's so hilarious. In Fullerton, Little Fullerton College invited me to be artist resident. I said, I never looked down any smaller schools. I want to have fun, it's California. I went there, they shipped my canvas beforehand. It's 80 by 80, a canvas. It's on big stage, it's much bigger. Two video cameras there. Like 100 people sitting there. I said, what do you want me to do? You know, I have to paint in front, not of just people, audience, but a camera, you kidding me? And but I had no choice. They put me, so I have to think other things. Think Chinese revolutionary song, some ancient poem. Ignore the audience, ignore the camera was so hard. And also, at your studio, you know, you paint, you think, right? You don't like constantly doing that. Sometimes you take, you know, you stand back. Maybe I don't smoke, so I don't, like a Chinese male, typical male artist, oh, very seriously, I don't do that. But I do have a tea, and then, you know, check my email, and then I come. But there, you on stage, you cannot take a break. So I have to say, okay, I have to keep going. I cannot stop. And even just, you know, like a 10 second, I look back, it's like, okay, I'll go back, the painting. 80 by 80 is pretty big. I got on the ladder on different things. That was the time I did it for the college. And it was very intense. So the end of it, I did a quick thing. I said, I'll show you how to, for example, this is my photograph of that deer. I love deer, and even the dad, they're so graceful. I said, let me do it. And I heard the time counting down, like 1 minute, 2 minutes. I did in 20 some minutes, everybody watching. And that intensity, I learned one thing. When you are watched, you have the intensity, because you're not really painting, you're performing. You're performing for the audience, you're performing for the camera. So that's a different kind of shift of gear. So that's the experience I had. But otherwise, I paint privately. Probably Michael didn't see me paint when he was there. I hope not.
A few times. I saw my role as the the studio manager as being somebody to take care of some of those elements so that Hung didn't have those kind of outside pressures on herself so that she could focus. And as a young artist, trying to learn the ins and outs and the back room of the gallery museum thing, it was an amazing experience to really see what that infrastructure was like, what all the things that you have to do, like the grant application for the Guggenheim. Oh my gosh, that thing is the worst. Some of these laborious tasks that artists have to do that a lot of the public has no idea how much time artists have to spend filling out forms and grant applications and submitting writing for this or that or replying to email. I mean, there's an enormous amount of time that an artist, especially of Hung's caliber, has to spend with these things. So as a young artist, it was really impactful for me to actually see that side of it. And I learned a lot and hopefully shielded Hung from some of that. And learned a lot of about writing from Jeff. And still got some to learn there, Jeff. It's an amazing experience, and it's one that I actually recommend to students all the time. If they have the opportunity to work with an artist, even if it's a brief period, I really encourage artists to do that, young artists to do that, because you can learn so much, even if you're not painting. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've also worked for artists where I've painted their paintings before, but...
not Chinese.
No. But, you know, that you learn something else in that, but it was, yeah.
We also say that to young artists that coming here and doing an internship at the Richmond Art Center also will bring you great experience in terms of seeing exactly how artists submit their work, how they write about their work, how grants are put together, everything, every aspect of the whole exhibition process too, from beginning to end. That it's all experience. And I think it's very easy to go through art school and be clueless and really not have any sense of what's entailed. That has nothing to do with what you're doing in your studio, necessarily.
Yeah, and that's kind of, I'm sorry, I'm gonna just dovetail off that. That's kind of one of the things that I learned, that I kind of base some of my teaching on as well, is the things that I felt like I missed when I was an undergraduate, especially the items that I thought that I should have been taught or that I found out later that might have been better earlier on. That's something that really drives like my individual teaching practice. Like, you know, oh, you know, we should have definitely learned how to fill out, you know, a grant application. We should have known how to, you know, apply for a residency or do something like that. But when I graduated undergrad in 2006, it was just like, here you go. Have fun in the world. Mm-hmm. Good luck on your 10,000 hours.
I also, in my experience, it's important that when you design the curriculum, you need to almost put pressure on the students, but not you do it, the thinking for them. Make them work. Mm-hmm. And there's a few assignments I remember. One is that sometimes, I think I read from a Russian writer, I don't remember the name. I think I just paraphrase, it said that some people not really interested in the art, but they are attracted to the art can make the atmosphere. It's like art is so cool, romantic, this and that. As if artists don't need to work hard, just being artists, enjoy being artists. Such a great name, I'm artist. And then I said, art is very hard work. You know, we had a friend that said, I don't know if my work is art, my art is work. And then I designed, I have an assignment over the years, and I did with undergrad, a grad. We bought paper for them, remember, the same size paper. We hand out, everybody equally get this size, same size paper. You have to work on it for 20 hours. I'm not saying one day, okay. It's maybe in within 3 or 4 weeks period, you have to do 20 hours on this piece of paper, no pencil, no eraser allowed, only pen. And I don't care what you do. You can just use your pen, just go over one layer, the other, you cover the whole, you know, piece of paper, I don't care. You cover surface by human figure, by abstract form, by writing, I don't care, but you have to do your time. And I said, if you cheat, I know, because I know how long 20 hours, you know, could be. And they really some great work. I just always remember some, you know, did like just a piece of like a crystallized black paper with some chips, something, did 50 hours, this woman. And some just said, I don't know what to do. I said, you can start with anything, everything, and then just keep going. It's like a life. You make mark, we have the mark. The mark is this show, it's the making mark. You make mark, you not always expect to be able to erase it. Live with the mark, keep going. Maybe you think, you thought it in the beginning was a mistake. Then you go over it and maybe you use it as a base for something else. Keep going. So they really seriously document. Tuesday I did 13 minutes. And Thursday, because I told them I know whoever cheated. And Thursday I did 45 minutes and then the 2 hours. And when they turned in, that was the moment. I love that critique, because everybody put on the wall, you know, it's document, it's a record of time they did. So it's time is what? It's the component of life. So they spend also use their own hand. Some used up like 10 pens or 20 pens. Just keep going. But what I like about this kind of assignment, because I almost, you know, in a way, nicely, but forced them to work, to go through the agony from the beginning to the middle and to the end. And some could not stop. That's why a lot of them way over 20 hours. So I think that's a kind of being a teacher, I think a design what kind of classes they are interested in it, but also challenging. It's not an easy, hey baby, it's great, I love your work, awesome, not that. So also critique, as I said, let's try not use a lot of adjective. Like, oh, great, oh, lovely, oh, God, awesome. I said, let's see something concrete, because a critique is not a criticism. It's about bringing awareness. Like, you know, the same subject matter, we can do, yeah, 20 people doing 20 different ways. So I think like, you know, we cannot transfer one experience to another person, but we can transcend into artwork. Then we share something. So I think that experience is very important for the student to feel safe, yet to be challenged, and dare to say, I see this work, I saw this part. Have you ever thought if you change that, make it darker, what will happen? They do give each other very serious critiques. I was so proud of them over the years. And nobody just like, have like, oh great, like, well, yeah. I think that's sometimes meaningless to me.
I think we can tell from the critical approach and the rigor of your own work, and that your students have benefited from that. I would like to offer the microphone for questions from those who have been waiting. Are there some questions? I could bring the microphone to you.
The painting that you had to do in front of the cameras and the 100 people, how did you like it when you were finished?
Actually weird. You know, that painting, definitely I could tell, was not done in private, you know, situation, because a lot of gestural, because I want to show off, you know? When you have a camera, you cannot help to perform. So some doesn't have to be so bold, you have to slow down, but I felt I used a lot of quick draw, you know, that kind of thing. I think I need when I got back, I did work more on it. That's not it. That's, yeah.
Your piece, Going Away, Coming Home, in the Oakland airport, has become really important to me. I was just wondering if you could speak a little bit about what that process was like or why you wanted to do it.
How many of you saw my Oakland Museum, Oakland Airport? Yeah, okay, that's the glass piece. The airport. That was after 9/11, and they built that new addition of airport for Southwest, and the glass, the media was given. I didn't choose it. Before they chose artists, they had decided to work with Direx, which is a glass studio in Germany near Wiesbaden. So they had this already pre-arranged media. You have to deal with glass. So when we did the proposal, I just wanted to open the space. And also after 9/11 until today, well, I think flying somewhere is not a pleasant thing. And not that you take off your shoes, and there's a lot of just anxiety, you know, at the airport and you know, on the other side. So I decided to have something uplifting. I borrowed a 12th century a painting with 20 cranes. I did that 4 times. So, you know, so total 80 cranes. That's one layer of the glass. The second layer, when we fly somewhere, we're going away to see the world. So the 4 sections, the first one, it's all, I use the satellite image on one of the 4th of July American, you know, satellite photos. So the first one is the Bay Area. Then you open up to the West Coast and the Pacific Southwest, then the whole world. So you go to the gate, you're going up, going to open up to the world, fly there. Then you come back. From the world, you nail down to your home, which is Bay Area. So that's that's the other layer. So one layer is I hand painted 80 cranes. Actually, I worked there. First year, I went there to test the glass. I never painted on glass. Second year, first, I remember I painted the glass, the drips, my canvas, I drips anyway. And there's an assistant, I think East German, a young woman, so nervous, grabbed rag. I said, no, leave alone. Now you will see more of this. but anyway, get on, finish the 80 cranes. I use a China paint. They have to be fired. And it took like 3 or 4 months. Each is 5x5, very thick. They have to lift, set up for me. So sometimes I paint so fast, I say, hurry up, hurry up, I need the next panel. So I never could see, because its total is 160 foot long, 64 panels each layer. So I could never, I could see most probably 6 panels. one installed, that's another story. It was amazing. But anyway, I think as artist, I talk about Michael. He was not a media kind of a bound, you know, like just I only do drawing, do painting, do sculpture or do video. I think you do the work, depends the situation. I think working with a print shop, I think I have a printer here. Sam, are you still here? Yes, Sam is gone. I work with Sam. And working at the print shops helped me because you work with other people, you collaborate, and you basically put yourself there and say, you know what? I'm going to learn from you, teach me. I'm just your student, I don't know much at all. They are expert. So that helped me when I went to Germany, you know, even though they tried very hard to speak good English, and so with German, English, and with the all the stuff, just a great experience. You know, it's very challenging physically, artistically. And also the food was not that great, right? I tried to avoid the German food, so we found a Thai, but everything on the menu in German, and we found to go to the Thai place all the time. But overall, that I thought it was a great project. Yeah.
How much of your big oil paintings are from drawn with the paint? That you don't sketch in, about what percentage would you say that you just paint? And then what percentage are you looking at photographs and mm-hmm. painting from photographs or just painting from your mind?
I use photograph a lot. And for bigger paintings, I use projector because it will go fast. I need sometimes charcoal or pastel. I need to do an outline. So I make decision on the composition quickly. I don't have to prove that I can draw. I can do that. I feel I just want to shorten all the before, pre-painting all the, as fast as possible. And then I do look at the photograph a lot. And sometimes purposely I ignore certain things. But I also, before I decide to do a painting, if this photograph gives me a lot of information, also I could foresee a painting. Meaning I look at this image, I can see a painting 10 foot long, 8 foot tall, I said, oh my God, this will be good. But in terms of really the colors, because I use historical photograph, it's black, white. So color, how to improvise, I had no idea. I just go on and start to make it up. So that part is like playing jazz, you know, and sometimes work, sometimes didn't. Sometimes so easy, just like write. Sometimes like many layers still just didn't work. I hated it. Once I remember I did a head of a nun, probably about 6 foot, you know, a Chinese old nun. I thought it's so great. I have this image of the close-up face with all the wrinkles. Just didn't work. I almost finished. I hated it, didn't work. I didn't know what. So one day I brought my painting class to my studio. I said, this painting didn't work. Anybody want to attack it? Everybody's like, ugh. And I remember this is a Japanese young woman. She grabbed a pen. She just did something. And everybody's like, oh my God, I said, it's not working. You can do anything you want. And then they started to do it. I felt like a class performance, you know, help me to kill that painting. Because otherwise I will keep it like, yeah, I've spent so much time. Maybe it will work. I think I cannot fool myself. So that way I also tell them, your work is not that precious. You don't have to, oh my God, gingerly, it's like, oh, $1 million baby or something. No, just do it and then do another one. This one, I'm so glad that they helped me to kill it in the sleep. And they also, they got a, that Japanese girl said, you so good. You know, they say Asian women kind of timid, that's so wrong. Japanese girl, go ahead.
Yep, Hung.
Where are you?
I'm back here. Okay. So when you were learning the social realist style in China, did you have access or exposure to the traditional Chinese painting style where they revere copying the past masters was essential, but also the idea of qi, where you bring your inner self and your own style to the forefront? Did you take any classes in traditional Chinese painting?
Actually, in Chinese art school, it's really very, very clear divided. In the school I went, it's called oil painting department. You do nothing but oil on canvas, even not on board, you know. And then there's a Chinese traditional department. There you use ink on rice paper, but under that the big Chinese traditional painting, you decide you do birds and flowers, or human figure, or deities, or landscape. That's so specifically, you know, like a trained artisan, you know, you're so good. I can do cat so perfectly, close my eyes, almost like that. So like birds or flowers, you know, how to do loquas, you have to do, sparrow, how to do butterfly, the whole genre, and the sculpture department for 3D. So that's how we learned. And only at the teacher's college, after working in the countryside, I learned, because being teacher, you need to know everything. When our teacher introduced traditional painting, everybody hated it. You know, because nobody want to do ink on rice paper, just is so boring, and nobody really appreciate that. It's like we want to study the Western painting. And so we have model paintings. You look at what from Soviet Union, we saw a lot. But luckily we had also seen some pre-Soviet Union, pre-1917 revolution. There's a realism in Russia already, like Rapin, Sulikov. Those artists' work, Rapin did Tolstoy plowing, because he wants to return to, you know, to the basic, and some historical painters painting historical themes, they have to have real models, each one. I remember when Sulikov tried to do a whole public scene, he needs a beggar, and he looked for this forever. Then he found a grave digger, that guy, so perfect with messy hair and bulging eyes. And it's almost like, to me, that time, a painter, an artist, like today's producer, a movie director, you're looking for the right people, actors, actresses to play the roles. And then you copy them, almost like put this life person into my painting. So we had some of that as well. And then mainly it's after the revolution, the main job you have to do is to portray your great leader. Like you see North Korea today, like China 50 years ago, just same thing. All the paintings, a great leader, Chairman Mao with the peasants, with the coal miner, with the students, with everybody. And nobody has ever seen that, you know, but you just use photo, then use your imagination, and all the peasants working in the field, but always smile like this. No way, I work in the countryside for 4 years. I saw nobody doing that. We struggling doing that, really hard physical labor. So that's, I later on thought it's not a socialist realism. It's a socialist surrealism. It's completely fiction.
I'm wondering when and how you started to add three-dimensional items to your paintings, vases or shoes or whatever it is that you add to paintings on the shelves.
In early 90s, like 92 probably, I remember I happened to, in 91, I found, discovered some photographs of a young Chinese prostitute in the turn of 20th century. And they all like, you know, sat in the studio setting, like with props, you know, backdrop of the stuff. And they were put there almost like for mail order catalog kind of thing. So I feel like even if I painted perfectly this woman, that woman, but I feel like I want to add to intensify the kind of on display theatricality to that. So I want to have also as well as to mourn them, because in my Oakland Museum show, I called it titled Summoning Ghosts, because so many people died in China here anonymous. You know, I recently did a sharecroppers from Mississippi, a black woman there. Who knows her name? But I feel like if I do this, almost they have a place to rest. They have so that also functions as an offering table. So I really, when you add this objects in front of painting, you really push the painting back. So the distance, the physical distance, may be also the distance of time, because it's from a far away, you know, from a long time ago, but the image is back there in history. So that kind of work I did in the early mid-90s a lot. That one is one of the early work. That's called a souvenir. We go anywhere, there's always a souvenir shop, no matter in front of Eiffel Tower, Great Wall, you always want to bring something back. That particular image, the Western gentleman looks like from European, and the European countries, they in front posing, you know, tourist photo in front of a cage. Those kind of prisoners was slowly they sentenced to death, but slowly in public they strangled to death in that cage. So they with their smile dressed up. So I felt like in contract I want to add another panel plus. You know, the box push that back. So it's a lot of duality there. The love making scene of a very, delicate porcelain. Also, you know, as a cultural relic in France, taken by somebody to France in the museum as a Chinese antique relic. And the photograph also taken by somebody. So I think those, you know, it's very interesting, you know, to play it out. So I, a lot of my shelves or boxes always have the function, both as, you know, almost intrusion, or push things back, but also a part of, you know, I can put something on top, I can offer something.
Well, I want to say thank you to
Hung
and Michael.
Thank you.
We are We are so fortunate to have your work here with us in Richmond. It illuminates with great understanding, sympathy, and compassion. It's incredibly beautiful and powerful work, very important. If today was the first day that you came to see this exhibition, the show is up for one more week, and we hope that you'll be able to come and spend some more time with this work. It's been an extraordinary experience for us to have this all together, and thank you so much for all that you've shared with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.